Welcome back. We had a little break in between. We still have Michael with us. Thank you for being here, Michael. We have Michael McBay from Circle the Earth. Hi, Michael. Thank you for staying with us for the second round.
Thank you very much for having me back, Cynthia. It's always a pleasure to see you and be your friend.
Yes, back at you. So we had a lot of great feedback. You know, I had a lot of text messages that people were very shocked that you were so humble and candid, and yet you were able to like make it, for lack of a better word. No, that is for the best of the word, that you were able to make it after your trials and tribulations, and people didn't see that coming. And I think that's awesome. How do you get to a place where you're comfortable sharing your past, knowing that it's just that, your past?
Okay, so you're talking about my crack addiction. That's what we're to be specific. 20 years of crack and alcohol to balance it out, but primarily crack. So the thing about that is that it took me to a place of where there was no option but surrender and humility. I've been in jail 12 times, in and out, and was homeless for a while. So I was eventually mandated into 6 months of inpatient treatment by the, you know, by the state. So 6 months of inpatient treatment and a month of jail got to me finally. So, and I, you know, lost the band, lost contact with music, lost my dreams. And, you know, I couldn't even see the sky for a long time. So those things made me resolve to finally pay attention to the directions of the people trying to get, you know, in the recovery program, and put recovery first before everything, you know, God first and recovery after that. And then the step, the day I stepped out, I resolved never to go back because I wanted to get my dreams back together again. So I spent every day taking one foot in front of the other, following my spiritual path, and, you know, doing everything I could to stay away from drugs and alcohol, which for me includes voluntary participation in a medical board recovery group, you know, group meetings, and voluntary urine testing for the last 11 years. I've been sober for 11 years, and I've been doing these things nonstop the entire time.
So I totally get the idea that you surrendered to the fact that your life was unmanageable and you could no longer live this way.
Exactly. Okay, so I can live that way, but it would be miserable, and I wouldn't have music and karate and all the things that I love for my family.
But you couldn't, you know, as I know, that you couldn't actually be really living, because how functional would you? You may go to band practice, but it might be once a month.
Right.
Because you sure as heck wouldn't make it on time or as scheduled, you know, the dysfunction.
Right. I would eventually, at the level at which I was consuming drugs, I would have eventually had a stroke or a heart attack or something at some point.
Okay. So basically you would have killed yourself. And that they say if the drugs don't get you, the lifestyle will. If the drugs don't kill you, the lifestyle will.
For sure.
You know? And being in Los Angeles, sober, thank you, Jesus. Mm-hmm. We move into the spirituality part of our discussion, because when you surrendered, have you had a spiritual awakening, or have you had many?
I would say I've had many. See, the blessing for me was that before I got into drugs, I had a bunch of paranormal spiritual experiences, and I was with a spiritual teacher for a long time. And even that didn't stop me from doing drugs, because my guilt over my sexuality and my beatings and self-esteem and all that drove my addiction. And those are issues that I hadn't addressed fully. Right. But because of my spiritual foundation, I guess I would say, it was easier for me to accept the, you know, the high power concept and surrendering to God and all that, than a person that's an atheist. So I've had direct spiritual experiences that allowed me to embrace the recovery program much more easily than a person who has not. And it actually added to my spiritual awareness and my spiritual foundation. It made my path more solid.
Well, and I always believe when people say, if you don't have a God, you can use mine. I've heard that saying, but I truly believe that our own search for our higher power, for Jesus, for God, Buddha, is an individual. And I always tell people, don't ask me. You can watch me, which some people think is arrogant. Don't ask me. Ask God to show himself to you, to reveal.
Agreed.
Yes. So tell me about the experience. I think one time, and I found it fascinating, maybe, and perhaps our audience will as well, but I want to hear it again. You told me a story about a letter. Do you remember the story? Okay.
Of course.
Okay.
So this is I had had a bunch of paranormal experiences as a kid, but I didn't have any proof that they were real, you know? So the first thing that happened to me where I actually had some external validation was when I was a junior in college. My very best friend was a guy named Fred, who was super smart. We were both pre-med and we studied together. He was smarter than me. And we studied together for the first 3 years. So summer of my junior year, he went to England to study at Stanford in England for the summer. And I stayed at Stanford in Palo Alto to work in the psych department and keep training karate for the summer. So one night I had this dream, and in this dream I rise out of the ground in a vapor form at night. I see the tread of a tire, because I'm small at first. I materialize next to a car. I see the tire. I assume human form. I'm looking around. It's evening time. There's a house. The moon is out. The stars are out. The trees are blowing in the wind. It's nighttime. I walk into the house. There's a party going on. I look in the living room. I see a girl who eventually I meet in my life, but I didn't know who she was at that point. I turn to the left and I go into this room, and there's Fred in the room. And I'm like, Fred, what are you doing in my dream? And he said, I think I'm asleep in England and we're having a shared dream experience. I'm like, that's not possible. That's ridiculous. I'm just dreaming and you're in my dream. That's all. So he goes, well, wherever we are, physical reality is controlled by the mind. And I'll show you. Watch this. So he waves his hand and the ceiling disappears and you can see the stars come out in the sky. And then he waves his hand again. The ceiling reappears. And he asked me to try it, and I tried it, and I couldn't do it. I tried 11 times, and on the 12th time, I was able to get the ceiling to disappear, and you could see the stars, and then the ceiling reappear. And so I go, that's weird. He goes, yeah, look at this. And then he turns to the left, and we pull a drawer, a chest of drawer. You know, you put clothes in. We pull the drawer out, look into the drawer, and there's tiny bunk beds and tiny little human beings walking around inside the drawer in a world of their own. And he goes, that's really weird. I said, yeah. So he goes, when I wake up, I'm going to write you a letter that this happened and see if you had the same dream. And I'm like, Fred, that's ridiculous. I'm just dreaming. You're in my dream. It's weird, but this is not a shared dream experience. I'm just asleep in Palo Alto having a dream. So he says, we'll see. So he shakes my hand. A vertical whirlpool appears. His hand slips in the whirlpool, and that's it. I wake up the next day, keep on going about my business, go to work at the psych department, train karate, blah, blah, blah. And then about 7 days, 5 to 7 days after that, I get a letter in the mail from Stanford in England from Fred with pictures of the house, pictures of the ceiling, pictures of the chest of drawers. Did you have this dream? And when I read that, I was frightened, of course, at first. But after I got over my shock, like I was afraid to sleep by myself for the next 3-4 days. But after I got over it, I realized that there's obviously some aspects to reality that I'm not being taught as a scientist. And I was intensely curious. I said, well, if this is true, that means the things that were happening to me as a child that my parents told me were not real were probably true too. So I just decided at that point to spend the rest of my life figuring this shit out. So I just started reading every spiritual book I could. When I came to Los Angeles, I got the whole lifetimes, and me and a friend of mine went to every single spiritual organization, A through Z. It took 2 years, mm-hmm. but you know, we did like a research study. Eventually many more things happened.
Yeah.
But to make a long story short, that was my first experience that let me know there was some paranormal shit going on.
Okay, so I'd like to interject. Do you remember being on the show? Well, you remember my show, you coming on my show a few times, LA Talk Radio, sure. The Hammerway Show.
Of course.
Do you remember the part that I shared? Do you recall any of it?
I remember that you did, and I was very struck by it, but I can't remember the details of it.
Well, I wrote it down because that's going to be part of one of my books that I write, like my seventh book or my last. But anyway, I had a dream many times as a kid about two men. You're a little younger, and there's a letter, and there's a secret in the letter. And I prayed to God. I saw this dream many times, and I prayed to God to give me the answer to know what's in the letter because I see the whole scene. Mm-hmm. So anyway, on the radio show, when you were just talking and telling a story, you revealed this story to me, and I described your friend before I even met him.
Oh, wow. Great.
And you said, that is the guy. And mm-hmm. so I had said that he had, I think he had curly hair or brown thick hair. Did we say yeah, and glasses?
Right. Yeah.
Because as a kid, the memory is dull, but I see the dream. And I know when you mentioned the secret, to me as a kid, secret in the letter. When uh-huh. you told me the reveal was inside the letter, God revealed to me that that's it. That's the letter. Uh-huh. That's the dream you've been having. So
that's great.
I do believe, well, there's a lot too. I mean, I get a lot. Like, sure. I do believe in the spiritual realm of the power of God on a whole nother level. Like, we don't even exactly. come close.
Exactly. Yeah, sure.
But that's a sure. lot of the incidents, like you said, you know, I will dream about people that I haven't met yet, and then I meet them, and God reveals to me in my spirit. So I know, well, I have seen you, and I don't care if we freak people out, but this is truth, and I mentioned it to you. I have seen you long before I met you, and that's wow. why we're friends, because I trust great. God.
Uh-huh.
He doesn't scare me anymore. It did scare me as a kid, Michael, but the more you tap into God, like you said, the more he'll reveal it to you, but he'll reveal it to you when he's ready.
Yeah.
Okay. So we're gonna stay there just for a second, but switch it over into the music side, because uh-huh. when you have a strong relationship with God, how do you handle rejection? I'm glad you laughed. We lightened it up a little bit.
Handling rejection is like the basis of musical endeavor in Los Angeles, because the market is so saturated and competitive.
Yeah,
quality almost has very little to do with it. It's more about connections and image and numbers and being current and all those things, a lot more than it is talent, a lot. Talent matters, but it's not the most important thing, unfortunately.
Yeah. Okay. I'm glad you said that, because it can be frustrating. You know, I will connect with you as an artist
mm-hmm.
through my writing, that I've only had one time. Well, I've had many times where they didn't want my little black ass in there. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But
sure.
I'll just say it. I hate using the word black and white. In LA, it don't matter, because, well, some people will beg to differ, but people can be nasty in all hues.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
They didn't want me to play the rock clubs because I was a black. When I was in Talisman, when most of the players are black, even though we're doing jazz rock, they didn't want us in the rock clubs. They had the hardest time. It was the truth.
Yeah, exactly. So I've only called one person a jackass, because I knew I was never mm-hmm. coming back. And I'm talking, I had been there many, many times and was honored, and was a great, had a great signing. And I mean, maybe 5 years in a row, twice a year, asked to come back, no problem, you know, getting the booking for the signing. And it's always that damn new person that doesn't give you your props.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
And she said something to me on the slide, and I just had enough, because, you know, I'm very kind, I'm very humble, but I don't go around saying who I am. But you do have to give me some respect if I'm giving it mm-hmm. to you, because I don't need to be in this little dusty place, is what I wanted to say. But I did, because I appreciate it, and I'm there for my fans and my readers, and I'm there because I love what I do. But I called them a jackass going out the door. It felt good, but I didn't feel good about it, because I try to be a professional. But jackass, I let her off easy. Have you ever lost your cool in a public? Because you're pretty cool.
Yeah, I have, though. Yeah, that happened. You know, I grew up in Georgia, so it happened to me a lot. I can't even tell you how much. But, yeah, it wasn't long ago, actually. I mentioned it in my recovery group about 6 months ago. This after all the Rodney King stuff was going on. I was at UCLA Ralph's, and there was a little black lady who was a security guard, and there was a redneck white woman, three times her size, walking out of the store with stealing something. So the security guard goes, "Please, ma'am, you have to return that. You can't just walk out with it." She turns around, starts screaming at her, "How dare you talk to me? Who do you think you are? Go back to Compton," and all this kind of stuff. And I lost it and went up to the white woman and screamed at her, "How dare you say that to her? Who the fuck do you think you are, you nasty white?" I went kind of off for about 30, 45 seconds, and it's not like me at all, but
no,
I had years of pent-up frustration behind that.
Yeah, okay. So I like that, because you know what I found out with artists? We're always keeping that face of professionalism. And we're human. It does build up after a while because you have to bite your tongue because you want to get in certain venues. And they even if they don't want you in there, then you know, you already feel if you don't.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
And they're already talking to you any kind of way.
Uh-huh.
But you do, you let that go because you're doing your, you're doing you.
Sure.
So
exactly.
That's thick skin. Yeah. So I like that. So we have, I wrote down a couple spiritual against the spirituality grain, why you need spirituality for these situations. How about envy? Envy. Either way it goes.
It goes two ways.
Yeah.
I am the least gifted of the musicians in my project, for example, right? And I have a tremendous hand injury. See, I put my hand through a window when I was high. I got it scarred up, so I can't even. I used to play with my fingers. I have to play with a pick, only downstroke now. So I'm a quarter of the musician that the average guy is on bass.
Mm-hmm.
So it's hard to sometimes.
See them jamming?
Say again?
See him jamming? See the guitar player jamming, you mean?
Sometimes I just, you know, sometimes I kick myself in my mind for having injured myself and watch the average 18-year-old kid can play rings around me and realizing that I did it to myself with my addiction and my behaviors. And so the natural base instinct is jealousy and envy and all that, but I at this point have been doing recovery so long, I channel that into determination and drive and compensation in other areas and all that as best I can. Try to be the best I can. I'm doing wonders considering I have a handicap, and I just got to accept that, be happy with it. I got a beautiful band, beautiful music, best players in town, and by definition, they're better than me, and I'm doing a great job. I just have to remind myself of that. And then on the other hand, there are people who hate me because of that, and I've got somehow I have to block them off Facebook and block them off my Gmail because they send, you're a joke, you know, who do you think you are, you're never going to make it, you're too old, all this kind of stuff. Those are actually good signs. Haters are good signs. Negative indicators.
It builds your base. It adds to your base. You know, you stand on it, the higher, you know, the more crap you stand on, the higher you get elevated by the Lord. You know, let's do a quick segue on the people who the naysayers, and let's play some of your music. Can you set us up for Diamond?
Okay, Diamonds is our newest single. It's coming out on June 25th. It was produced and co-written by Jim McGorman, who was a musical director and toured with Avril Lavigne. He's also worked with Gwen Stefani and the Goo Goo Dolls' last record in the fall of 2020. And Cher and Shakira. He's a tremendously gifted musician from Berkeley and producer. He co-wrote it with our guitarist. The guitarist is Kazuki Tokaji. He's an ESP-endorsed guitar player. I'm really lucky to play with him. He and Adrian Jones, our longtime songwriter, wrote the song together. And then Kadir, our lead vocalist, added to the bridge and changed some lines on the verses, and that's how it came out. And it's probably our most commercial song to date, and it's called Diamonds. And it's about the pressure the musician or the person goes under in their life and the things they have to go through eventually to form their character into the beautiful jewel that it eventually becomes, like a diamond does under pressure.
Oh, awesome. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, here is Diamond.
Oh, feet of a million heartbreaks, bury them 6 feet under the ground. I won't hold you back or hold you down. Only diamonds are made under pressure.
I really am proud of that. Kazuki did a great solo. They wrote a great song, and the band really revved it up, and I love it. I'm real happy with it.
Wow. You know, I want to, you know, I interviewed Adrian. I remember, this is how generous Michael is. Let me boast a little bit on knowing him. He took me one day. I was like, Michael, will you write all this great music? And I said, who's the writer? And he's like, hey, you want to meet him? Because it just so happens he was heading up into Hollywood Hills. And mm-hmm. I said, hell yeah, I want to meet him. And because I, you know, I was doing the red carpet a lot in Los Angeles. And what the coolest thing is to meet a songwriter living in the Hollywood Hills. And mm-hmm. I thought it was very nice that you, because, you know, people are very secluded. What's the word? Is it secluded? They're very yeah. particular about who yeah. they let in their space, in their personal work. You know, yeah. it's one thing to come to the show. It's another thing to actually meet your songwriter and come into a studio. So we yeah. went up into the Hollywood Hills that day. It was a beautiful day. I got lost.
It was at Bill Withers' house, actually. That's where he was staying.
Oh, wow. Wow. Well, that was a nice house.
Yeah, it was. That was amazing
place. Badass.
yeah.
And there was a lot of great people on the street. You know what? This is why I like going to different places. I was able to tell people, just looking for direction, trying to find the house, that uh-huh. we had flyers for your show. I went old school on them. We had postcards and everything, and I passed out some postcards heading up that hill, and a few people showed up at the show. That's good PR, right. actually.
Sure. But that's you're old, great at that.
That's how much I love you.
Yeah, I love you too.
So, yeah, but Adrian was very kind, and he's a great songwriter, a young cat. I guess, and he's a young dude, and I say young because when I see talent and they're like 19 or 20, I mean, it just blows my mind.
I think he's 28 now.
Okay, well, let me ask you this. Mm-hmm. How did you find him?
Okay, here's a crazy story. This
okay,
is
God I'm for it.
Okay, God, in my opinion, is limited by nothing, right? Okay, so I'm on drugs years ago, and I have a friend who delivers drugs sometimes, and he lives in his van.
Only on my show. Good.
He's crazy, right? He thinks that the government has satellites tracking him, so he has the whole inside of his van lined with aluminum foil.
That's a hell of a hit.
And he sleeps with a hubcap taped to his chest so that the satellites can't track his heartbeat. That's how crazy he is. All right. So about I'm off drugs now. I'm sober, but I'm still friends with this guy.
Right.
So he calls me on the phone one day. He goes, "Man, I got a music manager I want you to meet." So I'm thinking, this guy can't possibly know anybody interesting. But I just, you know what? God's limited by nothing, man.
He may need to borrow money, right?
Right, right. So I said, yeah, give me the information. Let me call him. So he gave me the number to this guy named William McLean. I called Mr. McLean up. Mr. McLean turned out to be managing rap groups, but he was one of the most knowledgeable, generous, and humble men I've ever met in the industry. And he listened to my music, and he gave me all types of guidance and tutoring over the phone, and came to rehearsals for a year, never charged anything, never asked for anything, just wanted to help me because he believed in what I was doing. And then he calls me up one day and goes, I met this studio kid named Michael Wilson. You want to meet him? He's got a studio in Hollywood. So I met Michael Wilson, and we did some recording with him. And then Michael Wilson is out taking his trash out one day at 3 a.m. in the morning in Koreatown. And he sees some kids shooting a video. He walks over and goes, oh, I produce music. What are you guys doing? My name's Adrian. I'm doing a video, and let's trade numbers. So they trade numbers. And then Mike Wilson meets Adrian, discovers his talent, calls me on the phone and says, you got to meet Adrian Jones. I meet Adrian Jones. And from that point forward, Adrian's been writing for us for the last 8 years. And so I met Adrian Jones through a crazy guy with a hubcap taped to his chest.
Yeah. Hey, well, see, that's what happens. Spirituality.
Yeah.
And yep. Not judging, not passing exactly. Judgment.
Uh-huh.
Right?
Exactly. Yeah.
There's a big lesson there. And let me tell you something. I was going to make the comment of the guy in the van that either that was some good stuff they have in Los Angeles that he's, you know.
He's not on drugs. He's just crazy. He's not on drugs.
But listen, the way the government is today, I don't want to go. I can't say how crazy he is. You know? So
sure.
We'll leave
I don't
it
think
there.
They're tracking him, but they could. I'm sure they track people of some kind.
Right,
sure.
Right. So, you know, but I don't want to go too far off the cuff. So we have another song to play. Correct me. Is it All the Way?
Yeah, it's called All the Way. That's a lyric video that was just released this week, actually. And All the Way was written by, and I'm not exact, it was written by our keyboard player, Sandy Chow Wang, and Kadia Handen, our vocalist, lead vocalist, and Adrian, I believe, I'm not sure, and a singer we used to play with named Angela Michael, I believe is who wrote that.
Okay, very cool. Oh, very cool. Mm-hmm. Okay, everyone, here is All the Way by Circle the Earth.
Take me all the way, take me all the way, baby, take it all the way, all the way, all. Don't you know I'm only lonely when I look into the mirror? Crazy though, I got a million others trying to be nearer. I like who you are in your shitty car. You still open doors, and that's so much more. You don't show it off, but you show me off. Makes me feel alright. Don't speak, just remember tonight. Don't forget it. Don't think, just hold on to me. You won't regret it. You know, I wasn't looking when you came around with nothing. Crazy though, you're empty-handed, but with hundred into something. Oh yeah, it's not the way you talk, it's what you talk about. I know what I want, and you're good for now. You don't show it off, but you show me off. Makes me feel alright. Take me all the way, take me all the way, baby. Take and then I'll bring the class. Like it or not, baby, we gon' do something.
Come on.
Something.
Yeah.
You bring the bag and then I'll bring the class. Like it or not, baby, we gon' do something. Something.
Phenomenal. You know what? I love your music. I'm so proud of you that when we talked last week, you know, one thing people said that they liked how humble you were, but are you ever going to pat yourself on the back, or if you're afraid, if you pat yourself on the back, you're going to quit? Not quit, but like that you have achieved, because I know you like the idea of getting it.
Yeah, but yeah, there's no question in my mind that everything I've accomplished is because of the grace and mercy of God. That's all. I work hard. Yeah, I sacrifice hard. I would say I have a gift for finding gifted musicians and talented people.
You do.
Cause I've been doing this for a long time. So yeah. And I'm also obsessed with equality and fairness and sincerity and treating the musicians the way they deserve to be treated. You know what I mean? And
yeah.
Taking care of the artists that these people trust me with their careers and their time. So they'd all tell you that I'm obsessed with fairness and equity and things like that and taking care of them.
Yeah.
So yeah, I have these are qualities that I bring to the table, but it's God that's doing it.
Okay, I like that. And to all the people who always ask every musician, hey, want to hear my tape? Hey, can I sing in your band? I would be singing with Michael on stage if I could sing. That's how great of a friend he is. I know that. But I write books. Now, let me say this. If I took voice lessons, he'd probably let me come for an audition and hear me out. I may not be able to be in his band, but he would take the time out for me. That's how close we are. You're a good guy, but you know how you have friends and they say, hey man, you need a fifth guitar player. Do you ever get that?
Happens a lot, yeah. That's true. Can I say thank you to the band members in my group and all that? Is that okay? Okay, so the lead vocalist is Kadia Handon. She's a beautiful human being, beautiful singer. She has sung with Prince and Imagine Dragons. Kanye West flies her back and forth across the country in his private 747 to do shows with her. She's I'm very close with her mom. Her mom, trust me, I gave her mom my word. I would never do anything other than do my very best to take care of her daughter and further her career and do everything in her favor. And I believe I've kept my word with that. And I think Kadia and her mother.
She's like a little sister to you.
Yeah, exactly. Yes, very much. So it's a daughter, sister, mama sometimes.
You're not that old.
What the situation is. Sometimes she guides me. So it depends. And then on co-vocals, we have Lauren Richards. Lauren is a strong Wonder Woman type character, beautiful human being. Very spiritually oriented as well. And she just came off 8 years of lead vocals and show direction on a cruise ship. So she handles our videos, our wardrobe and all that. She's just a master at that. And it's a great asset to the people and to the project. And the other co-vocalist is Whitney Kaufman. Whitney sings lead for the Disney Orchestra. She's a superb vocalist, you know, of course, tremendously trained. Both of them are great dancers as well. So the fact that they've sung lead and managed basically their own situations brings a lot of experience, motivation and direction to the group that we'd never had before and enthusiasm we never had before. The drummer is Sandro Feliciano from Brazil. Sandro has played, he toured the world with Tina Marie for quite a while. He played with Parliament Funkadelic. And if you're really in the know about music, Flora and Aerto Purim, they're consummate jazz artists. He played with them as well. And he's a teacher at Los Angeles Music Academy. And then I have Sandy Chow Wang. Sandy's a TA in keyboards at Musicians Institute. Mm-hmm. She's a beautiful human being, great looks, and a keyboard wizard, plays on her back, solos on her, really strong performer. On guitar is, yeah, Kazuki Tokaji from Japan. I lucked out finding him. He's been in the band for the last year. He's endorsed by GHS Strings, a guitar pick company. He just picked up an endorsement with ESP Guitars. He's a tremendously talented virtuoso lead guitar player, really good guy and a beautiful human being. And that's another one that really deserves all that life has to bring to him. And then there's
Michael McBay. I'll introduce you. And we have Michael McBay on bass. Founder of Circle the Earth. Founder, right?
Yeah, because we're from all different age groups and nationalities and countries of origin. Our manager is Johnny Miller. He's a longtime friend. Our choreographer is Abby Ann Oliver. Her list of experiences is longer than me to name. She's a beautiful person and really good. We're also managed by Eric Klinger, and we're working with a guy named Steve Scherer, who used to be director of marketing at Disney. So we got a great team around us.
Shout out to Johnny Miller.
Johnny Miller at True Pitch, TRUPITCH.
True Pitch Entertainment. Johnny is the real deal. Oh, and that's another pleasure I had of meeting Johnny Miller. I mean, how awesome was that? I think, Michael, you invited me to a mixer out in the TO. I was able to come out to, don't tell me.
Revolver Studio.
Revolver Studio. Michael, is it Blue?
Yeah. Michael Blue owns Revolver Studios. Michael Blue. Yeah, he also helped us a lot with our recordings, of course. Yes. And he did One Republic and Colby Calais. He has a fabulous complex that has live performance venues, cameras, lights, and a state-of-the-art recording studio, several studios in his complex in Thousand Oaks. Very reasonable rates.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's a nice-looking studio. It's badass. And it's state-of-the-art. Go ahead, Michael.
It's a state-of-the-art studio with really reasonable rates, and I encourage anybody to go there to look up Revolver Studios in Thousand Oaks.
Well, I'm going to have Revolver Studios send me a check for us endorsing them. So,
sure.
Malibu, if anybody knows anything about Malibu Canyon, you just come up the canyon onto the 101, I think it's north, and get off on the TO and... Well, whatever, they can figure it out, but it's not far from Malibu. It's in a good location from Simi Valley, Santa Barbara. It's centered. You don't have to go all the way into the Los Angeles area and all the traffic.
Right.
So, I wanted to say that I met the writer. There was someone at the studio. At the mixer when you invited me. And it was, I think this one of the songwriters, I want to say Peaches and Herb. I don't know why that comes into mind, but I think it's something in that era. But I thought it was pretty cool to meet the writer or someone that actually either played in the band for the backup for Peaches and Herb, because I love Peaches and Herb, okay? Shake Your Groove Thing. Is that the right group? Shake Your Groove Thing, Peaches and Herb?
That's a long time ago. I don't remember.
Okay, whatever. That's before your time. So
no, it's not before my time. I just don't remember. I did a lot of drugs.
Since we're talking about Peaches music, and Herb, Michael, before. Do you ever go to the Baked Potato in Studio City? The Baked Potato?
It's on Langstrom. It's a jazz rock club, and I don't go there much because I'm more into rock, but all this, those high-end jazz players go there all the time.
Okay, well, I got to plug a good friend of mine, Kaylin Peebles, who's married to Bunny Brunel of...
Wow, Bunny Brunel is a world-class bass player.
Well, he's right here, baby love. My best friend is married to him, and...
That's amazing.
Yeah, Bunny Brunel used to play for Chick Corea.
Yeah, exactly, dude. He's a world-class.
I got an invitation in my inbox this week to come to their show. I'm not going to make it, but I've already sold some tickets for them. But Bunny Brunel and Cab featuring Virgil Dante, the super drummer. He is leaving the U.S. and going to Italy. He's a well-known drummer. Mitch Foreman on keys, Tashia Yangji on guitar, Bunny Brunel on bass, Kaylin Peebles on the flute. This is an all-star fusion, and this is the kickoff of their summer tour at the Baked Potato, June 1st and 2nd. Tickets are on sale, and the show starts at 8 p.m. Again, June first and second at the Baked Potato. If you're in the Los Angeles area, it's a must-see, right, Michael? It's a nice venue.
Yeah, that's a great place. That also reminds me, Circle of the Earth is going to appear at the Viper Room on June 25th, Friday night, headlining at 10:30.
10:30, okay. And then you have something else coming up. July?
We're doing an industry showcase June the 2nd at SIR Studios, and we're playing at the Coach House July 15th in San Juan Capistrano. That's what I got going so far.
Okay, that's nice. So that kicks off your summer tour, because I had did a quick infomercial about you coming on the show because you're ready to go on tour. So everybody's heating up out in Los Angeles, and the cool thing about it is people can't wait to get out.
Yeah.
And hear live music. So
sure.
Coach House sounds pretty good at the Coach House. The sound system's good at the Coach House. I've seen it before.
That's a fantastic place. Yeah, for sure.
It is. I like the whole layout of the Coach House, and it's beautiful.
It's big, too. Stage is big. You can run around. It's great.
Orange County. That's Orange County
Yes, it's farther south than that. Actually, San Juan Capistrano, which is about an hour south of L.A.
Oh, okay. So is that still considered Orange County?
I think it's south of that. I'm not sure. I think it's more south than Orange County, at least the north end of San Diego County or something like that. I'm not sure exactly.
Okay, well, it's beautiful. I know that much. Yeah. It's beautiful. Mm-hmm. So catch Michael on, give me your handles, Facebook, Instagram.
Oh, we have Circle the Earth on Instagram, Circle the Earth on Spotify, Circle the Earth on YouTube, Circle the Earth on Facebook. I'm old. Those are all the ones I know. I'm sure there are more, but those are the ones I know.
And you got YouTube. Follow Circle There on YouTube. Thumbs up. Like and subscribe. Also go to CYNTHIA W. Hammer. Pick up a copy of some of my lovely works. Seven Rivers.
Yes.
It's about revenge. A young girl gets jumped on the school playground by 9 boys. It's about first loves, lasting friendships, heartaches, and the courage to move forward. It's very self-motivation, faith, you know, what to do when nobody's looking. It's based heavily on bullying. Uh-huh. And if you want something a little more mysterious, check out my novel, A Good Case, about 2 Black caregivers, true story, working in Beverly Hills. The behind-the-scenes look at the billion-dollar home healthcare industry. People compare my book to The Help. Then you pick up a copy of Iceberg for the young reader, ages 9 through 16. It's a true story. When I was 12, my brother was 10. He fell through frozen water along the Chesapeake Bay. I saved his life. Iceberg is becoming a movie, but we'll leave that there. I sometimes you speak too soon and then the project stops and people are like, well, where is it at? Where is it at? Hello, did you not meet COVID? So everybody's kind of picking up their old calendar, right? And dusting it off.
That's right.
And then, look, hey, Michael, look. Now, where were we? You know, you go back to the calendar and say, okay, these are the projects that have to be pushed forward. But then you're out here trying to, I'm an indie artist, so you're out here, you're always trying to also do the new stuff.
Yeah. Gotta try to stay current. That's the challenge.
Yes. So speaking of current, because we know you're current, I noticed you speak very highly of the people in your band. And I noticed that the women that I've met through the years in your band have never had an issue with you. They always say great things and you kind of spoil them. How come you're not a male chauvinist? Being out in the music where people actually throw their panties at you, what stops you from being that pig, for lack of a better word?
Oh, my mother was born in Bainbridge, Georgia. Her mom was a daughter of a slave, and she was impregnated by a Jewish merchant that she worked for. And he wouldn't acknowledge that she was his kid, but he paid for her education. So she came out with she was a math genius coming out of a small town in Georgia, facing all kinds of prejudice. And she became the first Black woman to get a PhD, the first female or Black female to get a PhD in any area from University of Georgia. She had a master's in chemistry at math by the time she was 19 or something crazy like that. Then she became a professor at University Atlanta University, which is a seminal Black college, Morehouse and Spelman. I grew up on those campuses. So watching my mom break barriers and go through challenges and accomplish stuff that was difficult for Blacks and for women gave me a respect for them that on a personal basis that never left me.
Wow. See what happens when you just ask the question? I did not see that coming. That is awesome information. Thank you, Michael. You just inspired me. I mean, yeah. I thought I knew everything about you, and I know you're an open book and there's more layers to you, but thank you for sharing that, because I've actually had the pleasure. You've been kind to allow me to meet your mother, and she's, I say she's a, I want to use a cuss word, but I want to be respectful, a bad sister. She's a good sister. Like, you could tell she's a sister, and she's really, really smart, and she's a beautiful lady, and I'm just grateful to have you in my life. I don't want to get too mushy.
Same to you, man. Same to you.
We wish you all of the best in 2021. And in your famous words, let's rock.
Let's rock.
Let's rock. So thank you for coming on the show.
Thank you.
We will talk to you in the future. Everyone, go out and get yourself a ticket. Circle the Earth is appearing at the Viper Room on June 25th. I will be there.
Yep.
I will be there. And don't act like you don't know me when I get there.
I never do that. Come on.
I know. I'm already gathering up my posse. You know my little posse that I travel with?
Yeah, they're always gorgeous. I know.
Yeah. We clean up pretty good. But
you're talking about some badass bitches. Those are what people you hang with, dude.
Well, hey, I'm a little bit, what's that word? Shallow.
Yeah.
I like gorgeous people around me, right?
Of course, me too. I agree.
Shallow as hell.
Nothing like it.
So we have June 25th at the Viper Room. Now, the Viper Room, that's West Hollywood, right?
Yeah, that's on Sunset Boulevard, right across from the Whiskey. I think Sunset and Doheny or something like that.
Yeah, that's going to be a good time.
Yeah,
that's going to be a good time. You're doing your showcase. Now, is the showcase private, like invitation only?
Yeah, that's just, I can only have 10 people from the industry at that.
Okay, and so then we're doing the Coach House July 2nd?
15.
July 15th?
Yeah.
Oh, I haven't put it down. Okay, July 15th, the Coach House. Mm-hmm. So everyone, do we go to the Coach House online or do we go to Eventbrite?
They can just, I'll just have a guest list of people. It's all right. I'm still trying to, build a following and do that. I'm going to try to make money off it. So they can just contact me through Facebook. I put their name on the list and come for free. It's fine.
What? Oh, mention the Hammer Away Show and get yourself a ticket.
Yeah.
All right, Michael. Thank you so much. You have a great rest of the day. And
thank you for having me on your show. It's always a pleasure, man. Thank you.
You're welcome. Much love. Love you, brother.
You too. I'm going to close by saying that it's the same God in all the religions. We're just pointing left, right, up and down, but and throwing our salt on the left and right shoulders, but it's the same exact God for all of us.
Bye, Michael. Have a great day. Thank you.
You too. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.